Welcome back to the next session of the My City Real World Conference, and especially welcome back to our online viewers. Before we do anything else, I'd like to point out a special thank you to the sponsors of this event. The Policing Board, the Youth Council of Northern Ireland, and the Police Service of Northern Ireland have very generously supported this whole conference. Just want to introduce the panel principal here. Belfast might look like a normal city. Northern Ireland might seem like a modern place in many ways. But as you know, we've recently emerged from 30 years of conflict. While it's peaceful right now, violence is only just under the surface and often spills over. Stop every man or woman on the street outside and you'll get a different explanation for the troubles. A different solution to the Northern Ireland problem. Perhaps because each man or woman has a different definition of what that problem actually is or was. It's not for me to give a history lesson, but having claimed 3,500 lives and maimed tens of thousands of people, the Troubles have affected every area of life in Northern Ireland, none of them more than policing. During the Troubles, 300 officers were killed and 9,000 were injured while doing their job. The police in Northern Ireland, a bit of important background here, the police in Northern Ireland were known as the Royal Ulster Constabulary, the RUC, you'll hear them referred to as. It was reformed and renamed as the Police Service of Northern Ireland, the PSNI, in 2001. The fundamental change in policing that began then was a critical part of the Northern Ireland peace process. Today we have four very different perspectives on the PSNI. It's a great pleasure to introduce such a high-powered panel, and it's a refreshing change to be the token man. First of all, to my left, Dr. Joanne Murphy, a lecturer in management at Queen's University Belfast. Her publications include the book Policing for Peace in Northern Ireland. This explores how policing changed and its contribution to the conflict transformation process. It looks at policing from an organisational perspective and focuses on leadership, strategy and culture as it traces the journey from RUC to PSNI. To Joanne's left, Judith Gillespie, CBE, joined the Royal Ulster Constabulary, the RUC, in 1982 as a police constable. In 2004, she was appointed Assistant Chief Constable, the first female to reach Chief Officer rank in the PSNI. In 2009, she was promoted to Deputy Chief Constable, the second most senior police officer in Northern Ireland. She retired from the police on the 31st of March this year. And to Judith's left, Baroness Nuala O'Lone. As well as having served on numerous committees and bodies in the public sphere, Nuala is a qualified solicitor and was a law lecturer at the Ulster Polytechnic and University of Ulster from 1974 to 1992. She was then a senior lecturer holding the Jean Monnet Chair in European Law at the University of Ulster from 1992 until her appointment as the first Northern Ireland Police Ombudsman from 1999 to 2007. And finally, on the far left, Alyson Kilpatrick is a barrister who practices in public law with a particular interest in housing law, homelessness, human rights and local government law. She has assisted the Northern Ireland Human Rights Commission on accommodation issues, socio-economic rights and the Bill of Rights. In December 2008, Alyson was appointed as the Human Rights Advisor to the Northern Ireland Policing Board and has authored a number of reports on issues such as domestic violence and children and young people's rights. Ladies and gentlemen, our panel. We are going to ask our panelists to speak each for 5 or 6 minutes each to begin with. Then we want to open the floor to questions and answers from you, so please get yourselves ready. Thank you. First up, Joanne. Joanne Murphy is going to speak on the history of policing in Northern Ireland and the context of the reforms. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Tim, for that. Tim is a colleague of mine in Queen's University, and as such, he will understand that it is almost impossible to ask an academic to come up and talk for 5 minutes about the history of anything. We need at least 2 hours, you know, and a PowerPoint as well. But let me see what I can do really quickly in the time that we've got. The first thing I'm going to say, and I say this because, you know, I do a lot of these things, and I think it's important to kind of put this in some kind of context. We all have our own personal perspectives on policing. We all have our own personal on strongly held views. But what I'm going to give you is an academic perspective, which doesn't necessarily reflect some of my own kind of personal concerns, because we're all citizens and we all relate to the world around us and to the police organisations we come into contact with in a particular way. And I think it's important to say that because I'm an organisational theorist and I work in a business school. And the thing about business schools and management schools is that they deal with organisations as they are. And there's sometimes, and I say this because I'm really kind of, you know, I'm overawed almost by the kind of panel I'm on and the level of expertise and the huge range of experience that, you know, I see beside me. But I say this because we tend to have a fairly positive view of how organisations operate and what they do, you know. And one of the things, the fundamental things that we know about change processes in all organisations, and police organisations are just another type of organisation to us, is that the vast majority of change processes end in failure. That's the one thing we know, the one thing that every piece of research that's been done on organisational change tells us, is that these processes almost always end. At least 70% of change processes, you know, fail abysmally sometimes. And when you're dealing with change in a heavily political context, after long periods of conflict and trouble, you know, with a great deal of death and destruction and pain and injury on all sides, in the context of a long-running civil dispute and given the high levels of violence that Northern Ireland has been through in the past, I think from an academic perspective, we would have expected the change process in policing to fail, without a shadow of a doubt, particularly in dealing with an organisation which is complex, which is difficult, which has very specific, as all police organisations do, entrenched organisational cultures. That's a really hard thing to shift, okay? So I'm not going to talk a lot about the history of the conflict in Ireland. I think it's enough to say that policing was a central, you know, was a central player in that conflict. You know, that when we look at the history of violence and we look at the difficult road that Northern Ireland has travelled, the police are absolutely dead centre to all of those processes from whatever perspective you take, and everyone has different perspectives on policing. So what did I kind of find out from my research in policing, or what has kind of my work to date told me? Well, first of all, it's extremely difficult to shift an organisation away from its initial conditions, particularly in the kind of context that we were in Northern Ireland. So what are the kind of things that allowed policing change to work? Because I think policing change did work to a fundamental extent. Not everything, not every single point of it. I'm not trying to stress test pattern, but I think in general, the process has been to date a success. It's been a long journey. It's done a lot of very interesting things, but I think it has been fundamentally successful. I think if you took that model, you took what happened within the kind of RUC PS&I change process, and you put it in a different context, in another private sector organisation, or you put it in a public sector organisation, I think most people would say that was quite remarkable. That was an extraordinary thing to do. But I think because it's policing, and because we feel policing so personally at times, it's difficult maybe to say that sometimes, which is why I preface my remarks. So what are the kind of, you know, what are the things that I think were pretty central to the process of police reform from an organisational perspective in Northern Ireland? Well, I think the first one is leadership, okay? You know, and I think we always talk about leadership in the context of organisation, but it's absolutely central because organisations a lot of the time take their direction from the top. And police organisations all over the world, not just here, are, you know, largely, it's an old-fashioned term, but we'll use it anyway, command and control, okay? You know, so leadership at that point becomes incredibly important. Now, it's not just leadership at the top, it's leadership at multiple levels. So it's about organisations really displaying and adapting a level of leadership and an understanding of what they need to do to make a transformative change happen. So what are the other things that we see? Well, I'm afraid to say it, and it's a bad thing to say, given, you know, the kind of worldwide recession that we seem to be slowly crawling out of, again, from a business school perspective. But resources are absolutely critical to how you're able to manage a reform and a change process like this. So things like the very generous voluntary severance packages that were available for officers, you know, things like being able to kind of fund work internally, things like being able to take senior officers, and one of our panellists, I think, you know, I don't know if you're going to make reference to this, Judith, is one of the people, I think beginning in the early stages who went away on those kind of programs and learned from international experiences. I think that seemed, from my research experience, incredibly significant in giving people a broader, more international perspective on the possibilities for change and what could they do. What else do we see in terms of what worked? We also see the pacing and the sequencing of change. You know, sometimes when we look at change, we try to want to drive it very quickly. We want to move it ahead very fast. Sometimes, you know, you need to kind of calm the horses, kind of very Irish expression, you know. But sometimes when there's a lot of turbulence in the environment already, pushing through a change process with too much vigour at the wrong times sometimes has the opposite effect. The best known person to work internationally in terms of organisational change is a man called John Cotter. Any of you who've done business programmes will have heard of him. Many of you will hear of him in the future. And John Cotter's first rule of putting a change process through an organisation is the need to establish a sense of urgency. Well, you know, I don't think within the RUC and PSNI that people did establish a sense of urgency, because frankly there was no need. There was plenty of urgency in the external environment as it was. So, you know, what the books tell us about managing change isn't actually always what you need to do organisationally. These things are very context specific. And what's the last big lesson? And I'm really expecting you to keep me here on time, so you have to shout at me when I need to stop. What's the last big lesson? And I think this is the most important lesson for, you know, this group and this organisation. The thing that I saw that was absolutely critical to the change process in the police in Northern Ireland was the role of external individuals in impacting and influencing that change. So people coming from the third sector, people coming from non-governmental organisations, academics, mediators, community relations professionals, you know, people who were active in youth work, people who were able to give the police, who were operating at the time, a different perspective on the world around them. Because I think it's fair to say that after moving through the period of the conflict, police in Northern Ireland, you know, and I think would probably regard themselves as being fairly insular. And there are lots of reasons for that, you know, and we can explain that in the context of what was going on. But I think having the opportunity to really begin to structurally engage with people coming from all sorts of other sectors is very, very significant. Now, was it easy for the police to do that? No, it wasn't. Was it easy for the people within those sectors to engage with the police at times? No, it wasn't. So I would have a lot of colleagues who were involved in that work who said, you know, we were heavily criticised for talking to the police. You know, there was a lot of other stuff going on, Drumcree was happening. People didn't want us to talk to the police. They didn't think we should. Well, that's not really a strategy that works in the long term. You know, if you want to create change, then everybody has to be part of the change process. I'm sure that's 5 minutes, is it? So that's a very, very quick kind of run through what I do. I'm very happy to take any questions, but you've got a lot of, you know, far more eminent women on the panel than me. So thank you very much for your time and your attention.
Well, good morning, everybody, and welcome to my home city of Belfast. It's my city, and it's a real world too, so you are very welcome here, and it's a pleasure to be part of this really worthwhile event. I'm retired from the Police Service of Northern Ireland, as Joanne has already referred to, so I am perhaps a little bit more relaxed in my views now that I can express, but I want to make it clear that I'm not speaking on behalf of PSNI, but I very much hope that the police officers in the audience, and they're the ones in the suits, guys, you can pick them out straight away, I'm sure that they'll probably agree with most of what I say, and if they don't, they can jump up and say so. So, according to the Office of National Statistics in the United Kingdom, Northern Ireland people are amongst the happiest in the UK. And if you read our newspapers, that might be difficult to believe, but it's true. And whilst we are a society still emerging from conflict, I think it's fair to say that some incredibly symbolic things have happened here. That when I joined the Royal Ulster Constabulary in 1982, and you told me that they were going to happen, I would have said, you probably need help. Martin McGuinness, the Deputy First Minister, shaking hands with the Queen 2 years ago and then meeting her in private just a couple of days ago, an amazing symbolic event. The Queen going to Dublin and laying a wreath at the memorial there for people who died in the Irish War, the Civil War. It's really incredible Those things are incredibly symbolic. And to think that the county of Fermanagh would host the G8 World Summit, that the leaders of the world would descend on the shores of Loch Earn, again, an amazing event. And so we need to keep our continuing difficulties in perspective, because whilst we still have an ongoing threat from dissident Republicans, that threat is very real, and the police officers, I'm sure, in the room will testify to that. They probably checked under their cars this morning before they came to this conference. You have to keep it in perspective, because all of the attacks on police recently, the bombings, the shootings, the paramilitary assaults that continue in 2012, in that whole year, all of those incidents could have been fitted into one day in 1972. And that gives you a sense of perspective that whilst things are not quite perfect, in fact far from it here, they are very considerably better than they were some years ago. So I think we've every right to be optimistic and every right to have a vision that is positive for Northern Ireland's future despite our ongoing difficulties. So, of course, policing was part of the problem here, but it was also a huge part of the solution. And Joanne referred to the 10-year change programme instigated by the Patton Report and the Independent Commission on Policing in Northern Ireland. It made 175 recommendations, and there were more than 700 performance indicators for the implementation of those recommendations. Quite a bureaucratic process. But I would have to say that, like sometimes bureaucracy is referred to as cholesterol, there's good cholesterol and bad cholesterol. A lot of that bureaucracy was good cholesterol. It had to be done, and it had to be seen to be done. The key elements of those 175 recommendations, and obviously in 5 minutes I don't have time to go through them all, but the key elements were the fundamental basis of human rights, and grounding everything that the PSNI did in a firm human rights basis. A code of ethics. PSNI was one of the first police services to introduce a code of ethics, certainly the first in the UK and one of the first in Europe. And other police services now are following that lead. A straightforward code of ethics, not a complicated disciplinary code as we had before, which seemed to document every single mistake that the RUC had ever made, but a very straightforward code of ethics with a number of elements that made it very clear to officers that if they didn't meet the standard, that that would be a subject of disciplinary action. That the PSNI should be representative of the community that it serves, representative in terms of community background, religion, gender. And that was a very controversial change because, some of you may know, there was a controversial piece of legislation introduced to allow what we call 50-50 recruitment. In other words, for every non-Catholic recruited into the PSNI, a Catholic would be recruited as well. It didn't mean lowering the recruitment standards. Some may have suggested that, but it absolutely did not mean that. You had to meet the standard, then you came into a merit pool from which you were drawn on a one non-Catholic, one Catholic basis. And that affected very significant change in the composition of the PSNI, and it's now over 30% Catholic. And that was critically important from the point of view of community confidence. It's also, by the way, over 27% female. The police needed to be publicly accountable, held publicly accountable through the policing board and through the police ombudsman's investigations. And I'm sure Nuala will speak more about that. But those were extremely important confidence-building measures as well. And from the outset, that public accountability, both locally and corporately, and indeed individually, was critically important. And I think this is where the discussion around stop and search becomes very, very focused. I'll come back to that in just a moment. And the fourth strand, in terms of the critically important elements of the Patton process, was the policing with the community strategy. So policing was something that was done with the community, not to the community. And I happened to be on a work visit to New York in 1997, just when we were starting the work around reform within the RUC. And we met some of the citizens from the Citizens Committee of New York. And I remember a very powerful woman talking about, you know, often the police will talk about the community being the eyes and ears of the police. But we're not just the eyes and ears, we're the muscle and brain as well. And I've never forgotten that, because the answers to policing problems, more often than not, come from the muscle and brain of the community. They're not just the passive eyes and ears of the police, they are definitely the thinking, the muscle and brain as well. So in terms of the relationship with young people then, we would see this as absolutely critical again to affecting long-term change and the transformation to a police service in which all of the public can have confidence. Every single routine encounter, I think Rachel kind of referred to this earlier on when I was listening to her speak, every single routine encounter has a strategic importance. So every single engagement that a police officer has with a young person has a longer-term impact. And as we know, in Northern Ireland, there are still some people who have to make up their minds as to whether they're going to support the PSNI or not. And that routine encounter between a police officer and a young person might just make up their mind one way or the other. So every single routine encounter is critically important. In terms of stop and search, we have very rigorous powers here, very intrusive powers here in Northern Ireland, but they also need to be very carefully authorised, carefully recorded on each occasion that they're used on an intelligence basis, a sound intelligence basis, and subject to scrutiny and accountability after the event. Alyson will no doubt talk about that, but every year there are statistics published on the number of stops and searches, the powers used, and the breakdown of the individuals who are stopped and searched. And that's really important from the point of view of trend analysis, picking up any trends in complaints, and making sure that those powers are being used judiciously, sensitively, and appropriately. So just to sum up, because I'm sure my 5 minutes are nearly over, we're still on the journey. Far from perfect yet as a society and as a police service. But looking back, I'm very proud of the part that I personally played. I think civil society and politics have to catch up a little bit with the police service in terms of the changes made. And the maturity of the debate still has to ripen. But we are certainly on a journey and we're well on our way, and I don't think there's any turning back. Finally, can I sum up with something that I've always found very useful to remind me? It was Margaret Mead who said, "Never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world, for often it's the only thing that ever has." You can make small changes in your part of the world, and those small changes can lead to a worldwide police service that we can all be proud of and all have confidence in. Thank you.
Good morning. First of all, I think before I start, what I want to say, I'd like to pay tribute to Judith, because Judith has just retired and I haven't seen her since she retired, and her contribution to policing in Northern Ireland was enormous. And I think particularly as a young woman blazing the way and getting all the way to Deputy Chief Constable, it was profoundly, profoundly important for other young women watching, because it's not an easy business, policing. And you can get all sorts of conflicting emotions among the police officers around women police officers. I can remember when they started putting women on the front line of, you know, shield lines where the police officers line up where there's trouble going on. And the officers, the tall, big fellas, were saying, "This little woman, she's just going to be a liability. We're going to have to look after her." And little woman turned out to be the one who was actually able, by her body language and her talk, to actually manage the situation quite well. And she wasn't a threat to anyone, but she wasn't a problem for the policing. So I think Judith has done an enormous amount for Northern Ireland. And you know, most police officers who start off, as police officers, start off well, they do not start off and they do not go into policing to do anything wrong. My business was when things went wrong. As police ombudsman, I was charged to investigate criminal behaviour by police officers and to present files for prosecution, to investigate misconduct. And we investigated every complaint which came in. I've worked across the world on police accountability, and one of the things I've discovered is that in most places, the police investigate the police, and that leads to mistrust. In Northern Ireland, that is not the case. In Northern Ireland, the police ombudsman investigates the police. And you know, there are a variety of reasons why things go wrong. Political interference. Across the world, there's political interference in policing. And I think particularly in the States, there are problems with policing where the mayors are responsible for the appointments of chief officers. And now in England and Wales, I sit in the House of Lords. And I think we have created a problem because instead of having policing boards, such as they have in Northern Ireland here, and Alyson will talk about that, we have what are called police and crime commissioners with powers to hire and fire chief officers. And there's no process that lies behind it. So that's very, I think, can be very unsettling for policing. So don't think the United Kingdom has got everything right. It hasn't. And we can learn from the rest of the world too. And I think it's great you're all together. But the other reasons that things go wrong, poor management, lack of leadership, lack of training in management, you know, middle-ranking officers, sergeants and inspectors who are appointed sergeants and inspectors and that's it, there's no further training for them. Institutional culture, have you heard the expression the blue wall? The blue wall is when police officers close ranks to protect each other and to protect the organisation. And we call that noble cause corruption because what they're trying to do they think is right, but it's not right. Because if there's wrongdoing in the force, it has to be dealt with. And lack of equipment and lack of training. When I became police ombudsman, the Royal Ulster Constabulary had been fighting a very difficult war for 30 years. And they'd been constantly reacting to major problems, to bomb incidents, to attacks, and trying to maintain normal policing at the same time. And they just, in many cases, they didn't have the equipment and they hadn't time for the training, and that had to change. That had to be managed, and that was done. And the introduction of the police code of ethics that Judith referred to was profoundly important. One other thing which can be endemic in policing is a belief in the impunity of police officers, that if they do something wrong, the guys or the girls will close around them and everything's going to be all right. And that's not right either. Now, I'm just going to tell you two or three little stories. I meant to bring my watch. Judith, could you possibly give me a watch? Because otherwise I'll talk for half an hour and it's far too much of a gentleman to stop me. I want to tell you a little story about a guy who was arrested, a young fellow in his late teens who was arrested, taken to a police station near here, uninjured when he went into the station, hit in the face and suffered an injury. So the protocol we had with the police was if anyone was injured in police custody, we were called immediately. So we were called and we went down. And the young man said he had been hit in the face by the sergeant with a radio. And the sergeant said nonsense, he banged his face against the wall and that was how he was injured. So we asked for the radios and we got the sergeant's radio and we took it for forensic analysis and there was nothing on it. But the investigators also checked. Each radio has a number. Each officer has a number. And there's a log of the issue of radios to officers. And what we found was that the sergeant had asked a junior officer to swap radios. So the radio which we're given wasn't the radio which had been used, allegedly, to hit this young man. So at the end of the day, the officer who swapped radios with the sergeant accepted a caution for his attempts to pervert the course of justice. The sergeant was convicted and sentenced to a long term of imprisonment. Not for the assault, because we couldn't prove the assault, because the radio had gone and there was nothing to connect the sergeant with, but for perverting the course of justice. So that's the kind of case that we would have dealt with at perhaps the most serious end. We also dealt with all sorts of allegations of rudeness and incivility and failures to respond. And, you know, police expectations community expectations of policing change as policing gets better. And for example, I can remember, it used to be that the Republican community here didn't engage with the police and wouldn't support the police at all. And I can remember one day in 2003, about 10 years ago, when things were still a bit rough here, and some ladies came to my office, and they were from the Republican community, and they came and they sat down with me. And they said to me, Ombudsman, you know, it's nice to see you. And we had this chit-chat, and I said, look, you have to tell me what you want. I've only got limited time. We want our community police officer back. And I thought that I had sort of lost all reason because this was a community which didn't have community police officers. This was a community which allowed effectively the IRA to police them. And yet here they were coming to me saying, we want our community police officer back. So I said, tell me more. So this, do you know on the interfaces, we have interfaces. Have you seen the walls yet? the walls around Belfast to separate the Republican and the Loyalist communities. And where the walls are is where trouble occurs, and that's the interfaces. So these women, these Republican women, were working with Loyalist women the other side of the wall, and the police had provided them with mobile phones. In those days, mobile phones were very expensive and not everyone had one. There was one community police officer who was critical, and the ladies both sides of the wall had done tremendous work to defuse situations. As soon as the rocks came over the wall or the bottles came over the wall, they got in touch with various people, and there was an attempt to move the young people back and to stop it escalating into a full-scale riot, which would then draw the police in, and then you could have petrol bombs and you could have all sorts of things. So they'd done a wonderful job. It was the marching season. Do you know what the marching season is? The marching season is when both sides of the community take to the streets, but principally the Protestant, the Orange community, the Bands community, and they march to assert their culture. So the police officer had been taken away from community duties and put into a tactical support unit. Another police officer from up the country had been placed in to do the less important work, as it was seen, I suspect, of the interface community officer. He was a perfectly decent officer. But they had grown a trust in this one PSNI officer. So it was a win-win for me. I said, I can't tell the chief what to do with his people, but I will present him with your problem. And, of course, the matter was dealt with. It was a symbol of changing policing. Have I run out of time? 1 minute? 1 minute. Okay. So I can tell you many other cases. If you read the newspapers today, you will read about a police sergeant called Joe Campbell, who lived in a beautiful little village here called Cushendall, and he was murdered. And the allegation was that police officers were involved in his murder. It was 1977, 78, and he was an officer working down on the coast. He became aware of police wrongdoing, he reported it, and both the police and the army became aware there were threats to his life. Neither acted to protect him. He went down one night to close up the police station and he was shot dead. The police station was 100 yards from his home. There were two investigations, there was a criminal trial, and if you read the papers, you'll hear the story. It was a failed investigation. Documents were lost, intelligence wasn't released. The whole thing went terribly, terribly wrong. And you could ask how and why. And there are many situations, you know, in which these police officers, who I said at the beginning went out to do a good job, did a good job in the most difficult circumstances. I'm going to tell you one very short story. And this was a young police officer, two young police officers, just sort of out of training school, done a bit of a year or so of policing. They were following a stolen car in Belfast. The stolen car went off the main road onto waste ground. The police car followed it. The stolen car stopped, and a young man got out, began to run. The police car drove on after him, not knowing what the young man knew, which was that there was a river. Police car went into the river, and unfortunately it went in on top of the young man, who was pinned under the police car. Those police officers tried desperately to lift the car off the young man. It was never their intention that this should happen. They just didn't know the area, and he died. And we found no wrongdoing on their part, because they had actually been doing the things they'd been told and trained to do. That's keeping it simple. What I'm saying to you is policing is a complex issue. It can go terribly wrong, it can go wrong deliberately, and it can go wrong through error, through mismanagement. But I think independent accountability helps. Thank you very much.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for having me here today. I really am delighted to be able to join you, and I look forward to learning from your experience as much as I hope we can contribute a little bit from our experience today. I'm particularly honoured and a little bit thrown, I have to say, to participate on a panel of such esteemed women. I feel smarter just by being here, so thank you. I'm going to say just a few very brief words about the Northern Ireland Policing Board and the role it has played in and continues to play in the story of policing in Northern Ireland. I think a very important role that it has played. The Policing Board, to get over the technical bit, is an arm's length public body comprising 19 members, 10 of whom are political representatives, 9 of whom are independent members. It was established in 2001 in response to the report you've heard about, which was a fundamental review of policing in Northern Ireland, and it was entitled, I think quite significantly, A New Beginning, and that's what it was supposed to be. Policing in Northern Ireland was undoubtedly contentious, and you've heard some of the reasons why. I'm sure some of your preparation for today has flagged up to you why policing may have been contentious. There was certainly a deficit of trust in police-community relations, and that had to be addressed. And one measure to address that, alongside, for example, the Ombudsman's Office, which has been critical to addressing public confidence, was the establishment of the Policing Board. And importantly, a board underpinned by statute, which has a range of powers and duties, among which is to hold the Chief Constable to account for his actions. It's a fairly broad-ranging power and duty. A central plank of that accountability arrangement was the monitoring of the police according to a human rights framework, an international human rights framework. The rights primarily were those enshrined in the European Convention on Human Rights. To enable the board to discharge its oversight function effectively, what it did was develop a human rights monitoring framework in cooperation with and in agreement with the police. It had, and Judith has touched on this, as its core principle, the essence of policing is the protection of human rights. That's what policing is there for. That's what the police do. It's their job to do that. To put it another way, policing is human rights protection, pure and simple. To ensure the protection of human rights is practical and effective, because that's really ultimately what matters and what people will measure, the board introduced a police code of ethics, again, working with the police and in agreement with the police, in which is embedded a human rights framework, again, based on the European Convention of Human Rights. Throughout the code of ethics, it is referenced, it's underpinned by it, and even case law is cited in the notes to the code of ethics. Importantly, to make human rights protection practical and effective, that code of ethics and within it the human rights standards are what police officers' conduct is measured against. And that's measured by the police ombudsman if there is a complaint or an allegation of misconduct. The European Convention on Human Rights, should anyone want a starting point for a code of ethics or a monitoring framework, I think has proved to be the perfect foundation. What it does is lay down certain basic values, values which a civilised society would take for granted and which civilised nations, in fact, have been able to agree upon. It's really no more than a framework of basic ethical norms. Much is talked up in the press about how it's much more than that. It's a frightening, terrifying, get-in-the-way sort of piece of international legislation. It's not. It's something upon which everyone has agreed. Interpretation sometimes maybe it leaves a lot to be desired, but the convention is a really sound framework. It provides the police with a structure within which to make decisions, a very logical structure, and a means of documenting their decision-making processes, and it protects them in the line of duty if they comply with those standards. Police officers are charged with, on a daily basis, exercising judgments, judgments which affect each one of us, and how they exercise those judgments is what makes a real difference, is what we feel, how we feel about our police. It turns bad policing into good policing and vice versa, and ineffective policing into effective policing and vice versa. There must clearly, I would say, be an unabashed and unqualified commitment to human rights by the police. But that in itself is not enough. Sometimes it's seen to be enough that the statement of the commitment is doing the job. That doesn't do the job. An essential element for securing public confidence is not that the police are committed to protecting human rights, or even that they do protect human rights. They must also be seen to comply, and it must be felt that they're complying on the street. Transparency, therefore, is key to accountability, and that's partly the job of the policing board. And it's nothing short, if I don't sound too grand putting it this way, a fundamental requirement of democracy. Transparency has, to some extent, I believe, been ensured by offices such as the Police Ombudsman making public the reports, but by the Policing Board publishing annual reports and some intense scrutiny of individual areas. For example, you've heard mention stop and search, policing with children, young people, domestic violence, etc. It sets out what the Policing Board's view is of the police's compliance with those human rights standards. And again, that in itself is not enough either. The police themselves must communicate directly with the public. They must explain their actions, welcome scrutiny, welcome the input. Having this framework of standards within which, or with which the police must comply is one thing, and it's a very important thing, but it counts for very little if nothing is done about it if the police fail to comply. Failure to comply must be dealt with, must be identified firstly, and must be dealt with robustly. And I don't think it's possible to overstate the importance of that. The importance of tireless and fearless pursuit of wrongdoing. And after all, what is the point of a law if it's not enforced? It's not much use to anybody if it just sits there. What the board has found is that a commitment to safeguarding human rights, we've talked about that, the substantive and visible protection of those rights, and importantly, the exposure of violations of rights if they do occur, is the best means of securing our collective safety and building public confidence, and therefore ensuring an effective and efficient police service. Because with public confidence, with cooperation of the public, the police get better at combating crime. We all know that it's the public who provide the police with their legitimacy. Judith put it terribly well, maybe borrowing from somebody else, but I think it's indicative of what you choose to borrow as to what your feelings on this are. The public are everything to the police. We rely on the police. They're everything to us, in a sense. But they can't function without the public. And they've got to demonstrate to the public that they trust them, that they want to hear from them, and they're going to work with them. It's often suggested that the police, I think more recently, given some of the newspaper coverage of some of the scandals, police scandals, I suppose, particularly in Great Britain, that the police are more interested in the public perception, not really the substance behind any of this stuff. Now, the police do need to be aware of public perception, of public appearances, but if that's all they do, if that's what they manage, then they're clearly failing. There has to be substance to it. And the job of the policing board, and it is an intrusive scrutiny body, and it can be uncomfortable, but what it does is ensure the substance is there, and if it's not, that it reports to the public and it makes recommendations about how that will be fixed in the future. It requires continued monitoring, assessment, adjustment, reinvigoration. Times are changing and policing is changing, and the board tries to change with it. The Police Service of Northern Ireland has, I think more than any other police service, probably in the world, acknowledged that having a human rights framework enshrined in statute makes them better police officers, and it comes back to what I say about practical and effective policing that actually works. It helps them make their difficult decisions, it protects them, and it protects their colleagues in the line of duty. They understand that violations of human rights by police officers make the already very challenging task of law enforcement even more challenging. If a law enforcer becomes a lawbreaker, the result is, and I don't want to sound too hysterical, but it is an assault on human dignity, on the law itself and on all the institutions of authority. The police ombudsman is there to deal with that, and she did, and our current ombudsman also does. The board, I'm going to move on a little more speedily. The board looks at both policy and practice, and I think it's the practice, the operational practice, which becomes most uncomfortable. It's very easy to look at policy and make comments in relation to policy. Looking at practice and giving suggestions in relation to the operational application of standards for policing is more difficult, and it's difficult for the police. I think we have to accept that. I'm going to finish with just two short comments. What has happened in Northern Ireland, and you've heard it from everyone, and I think you'll hear it more over the course of this conference, as a result of the strengthening of the accountability structures, is that the police provide a more professional service. It's better understood, they are better understood, and more widely accepted by the community. There is now a level of support for the police that was unimaginable 20 years ago. And I say that with confidence. I grew up here. I could not have imagined the structures we now have today. With community confidence came greater effectiveness in combating crime. Ultimately, everyone wins. We win, the police win. Despite the progress, we continue to encounter obstacles along the way. You'll probably hear some of them while you're here. Each time we do, the institutions must challenge the police, call them to account, and report to the public about what they've done about it. And The policing board is committed to doing just that. And I think what everyone, and you'll have heard it today, what everyone is working towards together is a police service that operates within a highly ethical framework of principles, is held accountable to those principles, by those principles, and works in a close relationship with the community, particularly its young people, who it's going to be so reliant on today and tomorrow. It's what the community and the police themselves deserve, no less. Thanks very much.
Just before we go into the question and answer, can I just, add, just to try and open it into a more international context, perhaps? David Ford said to us yesterday about the public have more confidence in the police here compared to anywhere else, everywhere else in the UK. And it's such a, in many ways, it seems a good news story that the information that you guys are sharing with us. Are we actually a world leader in policing? How do we stand compared to other countries? Are there other countries that, that you would admire who have a better system? Or are we really doing as well as it sounds?
And I'm the accountability person who looks at these things, and I have travelled across the world to a huge, I think all the continents have now visited one way or another. My feeling is that in terms of the structures, the processes, the accountability mechanisms, and if you like, the spotlight that's shone on policing, yes, we're as good probably as it gets. It could be better. And it constantly, Joanne said at the beginning that change, you know, 70% of change fails. What you have to watch is it doesn't fall back.
Exactly.
We have the systems, we have the processes, but if any part, if any element of this big structure that in some way we all represent, if any element of it fails, and we saw it fail, we saw the police ombudsman fail, I think, in past, after I left and before now. that's fairly public, but... if that happens, then the whole process is flawed and damaged. So we can't sit on our laurels at all, but okay. I think we've got a lot right.
Good. Okay, can we open it to the floor, please? And Louis, roving mic, so please wait until the microphone arrives there. And if you could identify yourself, please tell us where you're from.
Hi, Lana Hollow, Open Society Justice Initiative, living in France. I have three questions.
Okay.
They're a bit maybe complex. The first one is on the issue of resistance within the police to reform. I'd be a little bit interested in hearing the kinds of resistance that you encountered at different levels, the beat officers, middle management, leadership, where there was where they actually did not want the reform and the kind of things that were done to fight against that resistance. The other is you mentioned the role of external pressure. I'm just wondering where the balance is, if there's a moment when external pressure can actually become negative, if, for instance, there's not sufficient allies within the police or that external pressure is seen as forcing something that the police doesn't want, where it can actually lead to them closing ranks and having a counteractive effect. So I'm just interested a little more in the interaction between the external pressure and what's going on internally. The other thing is in terms of... how the trust was gained with Catholic communities, whether it was enough to have these structural changes, representation, accountability mechanisms, etc., or whether you needed other specific measures on the ground in specific communities to build that trust and confidence.
Okay, thank you very much. Judith, could we start with you on the resistance to reform? I'm sure you must have experienced plenty of that.
Well, I mean, I think police officers, and I hope I'm not stereotyping here, but I probably am just about to, police officers worldwide are quite conservative individuals and are very often resistant to any change, never mind the big transformational type change that was going on within the RUC, PS&I. I mean, I can recall when we were introducing electronic file transfer, we had to introduce an interim file transfer, and there was huge resistance. This was the end of life as we know it, and it came in for a year, and then we had to change it to another system, and of course all the police officers said, no, we don't want to change, we've just adopted this new system. I'm sure the police officers in the audience will remember this interim file prep system that everybody thought was wonderful then by the time that had it introduced. So we are
resistant to change, and we tend to be conservative. And the question was around what was done to kind of overcome that. Well, of course, I think Joanne referred to the severance scheme, where officers who were senior in service, not necessarily senior in rank, but senior in service, had an option to have an honourable exit if they felt that this the transformation was not for them, or that they wanted to leave the organisation. They had an honourable and attractive, financially attractive way out. And of course that created headroom then when those officers left in large numbers. You know, 400 plus officers left every year. That then created space for the new recruits to be recruited at the other end of the equation, and for transformational change in terms of composition to happen. We also had a course that everyone right across the organisation had to undergo. It was called Course for All. It wasn't perfect, I fully acknowledge that, but it was a course that at every rank and at every grade, from both sworn police officers and unsworn police staff, you went through this course, which taught the human rights basis of the transformational change and introduced the code of ethics. And what was quite powerful about that course was the fact that officers and staff at all grades and all ranks trained together. And I thought that was quite important. And the trainers who trained that course were handpicked. They were very good change agents themselves, and dealt with a lot of very difficult questions that people had, and were agents of change because they were sergeants, they were lower ranking officers, but they were seen as people who were wedded and bought into the change process. And I thought that was very important too. Don't forget how powerful leadership can be at lower rank as well as at strategic rank within the organisation. And those who didn't, ultimately, who didn't buy into the change and who were breaching the code of ethics, were dealt with.
Thank you. You're talking about when external pressures became negative? Precisely. Sorry, Louis, could you go back there with the microphone?
Not quite. The first speaker, you mentioned the importance of external pressure. I'm just wondering if in your research there can be a balance where when you have huge external pressure, for instance in a campaign that brings visibility to a certain problem, but where within the police organization there's no support, they feel threatened, and they so that the external pressure becomes negative and they just close ranks against that change. And if there's sort of guidance in terms of the kind of internal support or things that can be done to avoid that kind of dynamic.
Can I say something on that? I think actually those two questions are quite connected in turn because it relates to the whole issue of resistance too. The first thing I'd say about, you know, this idea that people resist change and police officers resist change. Well, people don't resist change. What people resist, and it's a fundamental truth of change management, is being changed. You know, that's what people don't like. If you think about your life and how you react to change, very often we embrace changes that suit us at the time or that we're quite keen on. What we don't like is having no control over the process. So that relates, I think, then to your second point in terms of the role of external pressure. And there's no doubt that the policing change process in Northern Ireland was an exceptionally externally pressured role. And the level of external turbulence, you know, was extreme. The level of political pressure was extreme. The one thing I'd say, well, I suppose the two points I'd make are, first of all, that while there may have been a lot of political pressure, there was also a huge amount of resources in order to do it, and things like voluntary severance, absolutely critical. I mean, Judith makes a really important point there, but also resources in terms of, you know, how the organisation was able to put in place things like new IT systems, because I think the systems that existed at the beginning of the process were pretty dire, you know, I'm afraid, you know, but, for, you know, certainly from what everything has said to me, and that's incredibly significant. Also kind of little things, you know, like, you know, getting some control over what your new uniform is going to look like. You know, it's a very small thing, but if we think about how we operate on a daily basis, those things matter. The other thing I'd say, just in terms of this kind of internal, external dynamic that happens in these kind of change processes, is that leadership is the thing that really bridges the gap. You know, and should be the thing that bridges the gap. And I think that you know, at the end stages of the REC, the beginning of the PSNI, and for most of this process, you know, there has been very significant leadership at multiple levels. It's not been perfect. You know, we could dimensionalise all the difficulties with leadership throughout that period of time, but it's been very significant. And one of the interesting things that I saw at the beginning of my research was a comment made by the then Chief Constable,
who said in some internal correspondence with the organisation that this process was about making us better police officers. And I think that resonates really clearly with something that Nuala said. You know, 99.9% of people don't join an organisation to be really bad at what they do. You know, even if it's only at the beginning, there is some level of commitment there, you know, for the vast majority of people. And I think that's very, very important. And that's where leadership is really significant in terms of stabilising things, bridging that gap, you know, and letting people deal with those big external pressures in a way that they can. I don't know if that answers your question at all.
So, leadership and lots of money.
You know, it's...
Unfortunately, that does come down.
No,
that's
true.
There is a truth. Please do, yes, the gaining of trust with the Catholic communities.
No. Yeah, I just want to explain to you that the Catholic community is not necessarily the same as the Republican community, and the Republican community is not necessarily the same as the militant Republican community. Right? So you can't just try and explain things in simple terms. The Catholic community living in Republican areas were very much under control of the paramilitaries who worked in those areas. There was a disconnect, too, between the working loyalist classes, working class loyalists, and the police. And that grew gradually between about 1990 and the present time. So you've got lots of disconnect between people and police that had to be addressed. There were all sorts of projects, all sorts of money, all sorts of peace-building initiatives. But I want to talk just very briefly, if I may, about two things. One is that the police had to be willing to go into Catholic communities or into Republican communities, and particularly militant Republican communities. They had to be able to go in and deal with people who have been perpetrators of violence against them, the people who have been trying to kill them. They had to go in and learn to talk to those people before those people agreed to engage with constitutional policing. So there was this very careful choreography and lots of attempts to enable people, and it took huge courage. I mean, if you're the man who puts on the green shirt or the white shirt and goes out and somebody you know may well try to shoot you, when you meet that person, it's quite difficult to do business with them. On one occasion, I was blown up in a bomb explosion when I was a young lecturer in Jordanstown, and I met a man, a very senior member of the IRA, and he actually told me that that organisation had been responsible for the bomb, which I was pregnant, I lost my baby. That makes it hard to deal with people. So there had to be, if you like, a concerted activity within the police to overcome the resistance and to overcome the prejudices against the general community to allow them to move into a different relationship. And there had to be a sort of a growing of courage in the Republican community, both the non-militant and the militant Republican community, that they could move. So that when you know, we used to have a system of justice in parts of Northern Ireland where if you did something wrong that the community didn't like, you got shot in the leg, shot in the knee, shot in the hand. And they had all sorts of variations on this. That was punishment attacks. We had to move to constitutional policing. And that takes longer. The police will investigate. We'll get the right person, so that the wrong person, you know, isn't, as the paramilitaries would shoot sometimes the wrong person. So the police had to investigate. That took time. And sometimes the community were frustrated by the fact that people were still on the streets when they knew that these people had done bad things. But there's something around implementing the rule of law, making everybody subject to the same process, takes a little time, takes huge courage. It's a wonderful thing to be involved in, but it's difficult.
And time-consuming. Can you remind me, how long was it from the implementation, the creation of PSNI up until Sinn Féin exit?
2007, Sinn Féin, May 2007, Sinn Féin.
Six years?
2001.
So there was a 6 year, so could you, would it be fair to say that that's how long it took?
Yeah.
It took longer than that.
Yeah.
Because there was a working before.
Long and painful process, indeed. Okay, yes.
Okay, greetings. My name is Jabril. I'm from New York, and in the city I come from, we have a lot of police misconduct. We have police that selectively profile certain communities based on race, gender identity, economics, and it's a huge problem in the city where we come from that civilians have not been allowed to play a part in the public accountability with police officers. You have a lot of systems where police evaluate themselves and determine themselves to have either done nothing wrong or, you know, take years, and there's court processes that take a long time for situations that are injustices to be dealt with. So I have a couple of questions I wanted to ask. The first is when an officer is found to have violated protocol, be that abusing someone or, you know, even an incident that results in death. How quickly is that dealt with? And how publicly is it dealt with? Because one of the things that we see in New York is that officers are rarely ever disciplined, even for the loss of life that occurs in some of their incidents. And is that something that is dealt with swiftly? And, you know, I guess that's one question. The next question is, on the policing board itself, how many civilians are involved? Are they allowed to vote on officers being fired? Or the types of issues where there may be a difference in opinion between those in law enforcement and regular civilians?
Thank you. Nuala, would you
briefly speak? Yeah. No, if a police officer has done something wrong, what happens depends. If the allegation is received, what happens depends on the severity of what's happened, okay? So if you're talking about somebody who shouts and tells someone to F off or something, okay, that will be dealt differently from the police officers involved in the death. If there's a suspicion that a police officer may have committed a serious offence, then the police ombudsman will recommend to the chief constable suspension if the police ombudsman thinks that's necessary. It's the chief who has the power to suspend an officer, and that does happen. the police ombudsman will move in and arrest where necessary. The process takes too long, and it takes too long because there isn't enough money and enough resources to deal with it, so cases take a long time. But the system we have is that it is accountable. Now, I've been in New York. You have a Citizen Complaints Review Board. But my understanding is that what happens is the police do the investigation, the CCRB try to do the investigation, the police always get there first because they own the information. Totally unacceptable. And that's why I'm not sure that, you know, New York has that much to teach us about policing, if you'll forgive me.
No offence.
Sure.
Sometimes people try and tell us that New York can teach us everything about policing. I don't think so. So quick answer. I won't let others ask questions.
Sure, thank you.
Can I maybe just, sorry, Alyson, if you
want. No, you...
On the point of officers investigating officers, and Nuala has made it very clear, I think, that doesn't happen here. It's a totally independent investigative body with very rigorous powers and unfettered access to documents, intelligence, etc. And that's very important from the point of view of public confidence. And that's not a comfortable place, to be honest, as a police officer, when the ombudsman is coming in to investigate, and those wide-ranging powers involve seizing documents, seizing equipment, etc. But that's necessary for them to do their job and for public confidence. But also on the wider front, when it comes to complaints, there is a system within PS&I where persistent complaints in a particular office or a particular unit or concerning a particular officer can be picked up quite quickly as a tracking and trending system. And where necessary, remedial action can be taken, whether that's training or indeed misconduct action. So if there were a particular unit that were targeting individuals, that I would be quite confident would be picked up sooner or later.
I didn't hear, are there civilians involved in the...
I'm just going to deal with that one, yes.
Yep.
I obviously didn't make it clear enough. The policing board is entirely independent of the police. There's no police on it. It sits as an independent public authority. So it has, in terms of its membership, there are 10 politicians, 9 independent members. When I say independent, I mean non-political members. It's then staffed entirely by civilian officials. I am an independent advisor, human rights advisor. So I report to the board and advise them on how they discharge their functions. So it's entirely separate from the police, and I think essential.
So who appoints the independent members?
The Minister of Justice.
Yeah. Directly, David Ford, who we met last
directly.
Night. Yeah.
And I think if it wasn't for that, I don't honestly see the point of the policing board if it wasn't for the independence and the civilian oversight.
But to answer your direct question, the board does not decide if a police officer is dismissed or required to resign. That is decided on by a panel of senior PS&I officers. But if an officer who is required to resign or dismissed appeals his or her dismissal, that appeal goes to a panel which includes the policing board. And interestingly, more often than not, they reinstate the officer.
Yes.
Yeah. Hi. My name is Alex, and I'm from London, working with Fully Focused Youth Media Organisation and Release. And my question is for Judith, or maybe the Baroness, and that's, how do you think, or do you think, the system of police accountability can be replicated in London? Because this certainly isn't enough. I mean, something like 43 deaths in police custody and not one single conviction ever. There is the IPCC, which is mostly compiled of ex-police members. Anyway, so how do you think this system could be replicated in London?
Nuala? Sorry, Judith, yes.
Well, the current coalition government have been struggling with this issue of police accountability and have introduced the new police and crime commissioners, elected individuals, with the hope that that will give more confidence to the community. Now, whether you agree with that or not, they clearly think it is an issue that needs to be addressed, and that's the legislation that they have introduced. There have been some teething difficulties with police and crime commissioners, and I'm not sure that that is the answer. I think a broader basis of representation for police accountability, such as the model that the policing board has here in Northern Ireland, is a good model. It's not perfect, but I think it is one of the best. And so how could that be introduced? Well, you would have to lobby the Home Secretary and speak to central government and lobby your MP about it. It is clearly an issue that has attracted a lot of political comment. And, for example, I know the Metropolitan Police have looked very closely at the 50-50 recruitment arrangements here, with a view to considering something similar for minority ethnic groups in terms of not quotas but targets, and making sure that the Metropolitan Police becomes more representative of the community that it serves. I think also PCSOs and the specials have been a good way to bring people from more diverse backgrounds into the police. They get a taste of policing, and then they join the police later. But, you know, obviously we can only try and influence and quietly negotiate behind the scenes. It is a matter for central government what the accountability arrangements are for the Metropolitan Police. And they are, of course, different from the rest of England and Wales as well, because they don't have a police and crime commissioner. They still have a police authority, I believe. And so they are different from the rest.
You can look up, if you want, Sir Hugh Ord's speech to ACPO. He was a former Chief Constable of Northern Ireland and was subject to this sort of intensive scrutiny. And after he left, when he had nothing to gain, he recommended the policing board model for application throughout GB. And I think, reading between the lines, particularly in relation to London. Yeah. So, Sir Hugh Ord, O-R-D-E is his surname.
And just perhaps to say a word, you need a policing board rather than police and crime commissioners, because you need a range of experience and a range of ability to analyse, and one person will not bring that to the role. I'm very clear about that. Police and crime commissioners came from the States, again, with great respect. The States have given us many wonderful things. They're not a good idea. The difference, the IPCC you mentioned, and you mentioned former police officers in there, yes, there were former and are former police officers in my former Office of Police Ombudsman. You select them carefully, you vet them carefully, and you use their skills. But what you need to do is to, there are two things that I think you need in England that they haven't got. One is the growth, a real investment in the growth of independent investigators. So what we did was we came in 2000, we got a whole bunch of young graduates, bright young people, and we trained them as investigators. We sent them to the University of Portsmouth to do investigation degrees, and they came back as investigators, and they worked on the job all the time. It takes a while to grow that capacity, but it needs to be done. And the other thing that you need is you need the IPCC to investigate all the cases. They don't do it. What happens in London is they investigate a few, and then everything else goes back to the police. That's what happens in Dublin too. It doesn't work. Both our offices, the IPCC and the Garda Ombudsman Commission, were based on the Police Ombudsman for Northern Ireland, because we came first. Both decided that they would hand material back, cases back to the police for investigation. My decision was no. Every case will be independently investigated, and I am convinced it was the right decision. It's harder. The government will tell you, we can't do it, it costs too much. But let me tell you, actually, police officers earn more and they cost more with their overheads than independent investigators do. So all you need to do is take the money out of the policing budget that they spend on investigating complaints and put it into the independent organisation and you get more service.
Thank you, Anna. Final question. We've only a couple of minutes left, I'm afraid.
Judith already touched on my question, actually. Sorry, it's Natasha from London. How effective do you think affirmative action recruitment policies can be in policing, and what are their limits?
Well, I think the Northern Ireland experience shows that it can be incredibly powerful and very, very helpful to compositional change. But I think you have to understand how controversial it was to actually discriminate against the majority community, and there were many, many in the unionist, loyalist community who just set their face against 50-50 recruitment and never, ever supported it and never accepted it. And it was very difficult and very, very controversial. But all of that said, we were never going to achieve significant compositional change unless something radical was done. And it required a derogation from European equality legislation, which, because of the context of Northern Ireland and because there was political support for it, certainly from the nationalist and republican side, not so much obviously from the unionist loyalist side, but because there was that political will to change, the legislation was derogated. We were given a derogation and allowed to have this affirmative action instrument in place. But it was only in place for a 10-year period, and it's now no longer in place. So this current recruitment competition that we're running is under merit principles only. There is not an affirmative action process. Although having said that, sorry, if I can just say, what we have tried to do is to target those areas where, geographical areas where we are underrepresented, because there are certain parts of Northern Ireland that have traditionally always recruited police without any difficulty, and there are other parts from which we have never recruited. So our recruitment campaign targeted those parts from which we have not recruited. We took Equality Commission advice to make sure that that was acceptable.
Can I just kind of rephrase that a little bit as well, sure, and ask, how effective do you think a diverse police force is, and what are its limits?
Absolutely, much more effective. I think the community needs to see their face reflected in the police service. So that's in terms of gender, in terms of community background, in terms of the colour of skin, in terms of whatever minority it might be. It is important that those minorities are represented in the police service. It makes us much more effective. It makes us much more sensitive to crimes, especially very personal crimes like domestic abuse. And it means that we can provide a much more effective police service. You know, when I joined the RUC, it was less than 10% female. And in those days, as Nuala will know very well, we didn't even keep statistics around domestic violence. You know, and it's incredible when you think about it. And domestic violence statistics were only introduced in 1989. And so, you know, to put all of that in perspective, a representative, diverse police service will always be much more effective and provide a much better service to the community than one that is very much monocultural.
A real quick story,
okay,
Nuala, please.
Quick story. Just up the road from here, students pouring out all over the road, Friday night, lots of beer taken, etc. Students running round amok, police trying to keep order and peace and quiet. One student really giving off to the police, you know, you're bad, etc., etc. Police officers eventually go in, take him out, take him to the Land Rover, and there's three steps up to the Land Rover. He just got the steps to the Land Rover, and he looked at the officer who was arresting him, and he gave him a mouthful of offensive Irish, shall we say. And the police officer looked at him, stood back, and replied in very calm, polite Irish.
Oh, good.
End of situation. The young man apologised. Police officer said, OK. Diversity helps.
Well, thank you. As ever, Wim, you have such an interesting bunch of people. There's not nearly enough time for all the things we'd like to talk. Would you like to say thank you to our panellists today? Thank you.